Hello?
Jay, this is your mother. Your father and I are taking you out of our will. We feel you already have enough money. Oh, yes. And happy birthday.
Jay, this is your sister. You got a lot of laughs on the Tonight Show last night. Did you mean to have your fly open the whole time?
Hi, this is Gene Shalit. I'm having a bad hair day. If you don't believe me, look out the window.
Hello, Jay. This is your boss. I've just obtained legal permission to hunt men for sport, and I wondered if you'd like to come to my ranch tomorrow. Bring your jogging shoes.
Jay, it's Doris. I'm at the morgue. Could you come down and tell them I'm not dead? They don't believe me.
Jay, this is your ex-wife. Your alimony check is 18 minutes late. No, 19 minutes. That's it. I'm calling my lawyer.
Hi, Jay. I'm the winner of the Jay Sherman Lookalike Contest. Well, one of my heads is...
Hello, Mr. Sherman. This is the fire department. Your building is on fire. We would have called sooner, but your neighbors asked us not to wake you.
Hello, Jay. This is the devil. Despite what you think, I am not the reason Cher won an Oscar. I am the reason Marissa Tomei won an Oscar.
Jay, it's Al Pacino. Hoo-ha! I can't stop saying hoo-ha. Keep that in mind when you review my next film, The Godfather Part Hoo-ha! Hoo-ha.
Hello, Jay. This is your doctor. We've been going over your x-rays, and it seems you're made entirely of cheese.
Jay, this is Schwarzenegger. I'm having a private screening of my new movie, just for you. It's 3 a.m. down by the docks. Don't bring the police.
Good whatever to you whenever you are watching this episode of Successful Failures, where we will be checking in with The Critic Season 3. I have got my regular co-host, Tommy Secret Snake.
All right.
And joining us today, American Cupcake, who also has some things to say about Jay Sherman. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Coming to you live from Cupcake Corner at my house.
And Cupcake Corner, don't be too afraid, folks. That is not a stalker in his window. It's just Darth Vader. But he does look to me like Freddy Krueger at a lot of times.
I want to see the kids' reaction, because like the bunny rabbit thing from the other day, where the kids were just nonstop screaming because the bunny rabbit was outside the window. And like the younger son just reacted after his sister and was just
that
bawling.
Was a fun clip from co-host auditions with April Imholt, and that was a really fun episode. The Easter Bunny showing up very much like Freddy Krueger at night. You see why some mascot lessons might be important, because as I pointed out, like, he started moving his head like Chris Benoit at the window at night, like he's coming to finish another family.
It was a good clip, man. I love it when kids are being tortured.
Just a straight minute of screaming. And we have got a straight hour or so of screaming about how Jay Sherman did not stink. ABC thought he stunk, and it lasted all of 13 episodes. This is coming off of the success of The Simpsons. As seen in the intro, they kind of, like The Simpsons couch gag, they had a phone gag there at the beginning, and then a movie parody, and we'll see those a little bit later, and that's really what sold this show. The Simpsons in the early seasons had a whole lot of cutaway humor, and they got away from that. Al Jean and Mike Reese took that to The Critic, and I honestly believe this show was ahead of its time with all the parodies. There's just so much parody humor nowadays. The less talented Scary Movie producers who just went off and made Date Movie and The Hungry Games and all that nonsense.
Yeah.
That just remember where you saw this, where they have some fun with movie parodies. That's really the strongest point in the show. It was made for movie parodies, and I actually didn't love it as much this time around. I watched all 13 episodes. Tubi only has 12, but I found LAJ on a more nefarious site right before we went up, and I was a big fan of LAJ, so we won't have those parody clips where we have all the other ones. The story, pretty lacking. I actually have a clip right here, kind of to demonstrate how I felt about the plot in only 13 episodes.
Your problem is you're starting to repeat yourself.
Rain Man, A Few Good Men,
The Firm is the latest stinker from Tom Cruise.
He doesn't act anymore. He's on cruise control. I just made that up. Hachi machi.
So that's actually the feeling I got watching this as an older person. I enjoyed it, but I didn't love it as much. We kind of got some repeating stuff in just 13 episodes.
Oh yeah. That was definitely the first thing, because I did the same. I binged it and watched episode after episode, and you notice that there is a very tight structure, not just from the phone gag to the movie parody and the title, but they do the same type of movie puns or other fake movie parodies throughout every episode. And a lot of I think we'll get to it a little later, because he has a kid and it was on ABC. There's a lot of not so ham-fisted in some episodes, but it gets worse in some others where they're trying to push a message, like the after-school special kind of message. But one of the things that was ahead of its time right off the bat was the pilot episode. And he tells Jay to shut up, and your rating system is from good to excellent. Yes. And that is definitely something that is as old as time, but has come back around with a certain video game fence gate type of thing that happened. A lot of critics got criticized for giving every game at least a 7.5 or a 7. You know, it was a C rating.
Not the new South Park game, though. That one seems to be universally under the minimum of good. One that actually snuck through the good to excellent scale. Yeah, I was a big fan of the Stick of Truth and the Fractured Butthole. And this new one, it didn't really appeal to me just by on first sight. And the people who I've seen played it so far, no one is enjoying it. Back to the critic, the first episode had an actress dating him to get a good review, because everything stinks to Jay Sherman. And we got a few Jay romance. Actually, what I noticed repeating most of all was Jay and his mother before we get to the romance. There was an episode where they were trying to soften his image, and he goes on Geraldo with his mother. And that backfired tremendously. And then another one similar to that, where his mother writes the book, The Fat Little Pig, based on Jay.
That's right. That's episode 12 or 11?
That was the finale. The season finale was The Fat Little Pig. And I enjoyed that more. That was like a superior version of the earlier episode of Jay and his mother running into some problems. That was the same. Jay got fired twice in the show. His dynamic with Duke is, just reset at the end of every episode, where Duke has contempt for Jay and doesn't like him, but has him on his network. And he loses his job twice in this season. The one time English for cab drivers is where Jay wins his Pulitzer Prize. Again, it's seen by more people than any other venue he could go to. And the other one, when he becomes a trucker, I did enjoy the trucker episode, because it was something different, a little bit breaking up the formula of what we got used to.
Yeah, I did enjoy that episode as well.
And the one that I just mentioned that you may not have seen, the LAJ, he didn't get fired, but also, again, mixing it up of Jay going to the West Coast. And he wrote this fantastic script that's too good to make. So they hire him to make Ghost Chasers 3, a terrible sequel to a sequel that he absolutely detested. And very prophetic of what would happen with the true Ghost Chasers 3.
Yeah.
There were a few jokes in that LAJ episode. I thought as a Los Angelian, there might be like BoJack Horseman, I've mentioned, is very dense with more LA jokes. You don't need to live in LA for to have fun with it, but you'll have more fun with BoJack. But yeah, the LA jokes, not as dense. The farmer who starts shooting at the airplane because he's going over, oh, that's the LA flight. They give us this and that and award shows that gives awards to award shows. Get my gun.
And yeah, that's very prophetic too. I think everybody's about sick of award shows.
That was something that like just happened. I looked that up of an award show getting an Emmy or a Golden Globe or something. So they were referencing something very specific there as Jay went to Los Angeles. And I liked it this time around. I didn't love it, but if this show had come out a few years later, I believe it would still be on air today, like with Fox's animation block with Futurama, also canceled multiple times, brought back multiple times, brought back again. It's on Hulu.
That's what I was just going to say. They would have probably got a streaming deal had it hit its mark in the timeline. And that's a very important thing. Same with some of the other things that were just ill-timed or didn't get a good slot. This was on ABC. So you had to literally change the channel. And a lot of people just don't do that.
It was the lead-in for Home Improvement. And the second season, Fox kind of gave him a mercy deal. Al Jean and Mike Reese, the creators of this show, they kind of got a mercy deal of getting back on Fox right next to The Simpsons, where they cut their teeth for the first 3-4 seasons before going off and being like, hey, we want to do these cutaway jokes. We want to do this parody. So, what they were doing here, Family Guy took up the mantle of the cutaway jokes, not as dense with the cutaway jokes, but the parodies galore that it's like looking back where films started referencing other films and pop culture that didn't really become too much of a thing, like Game Over, Man, in Aliens. Right. Ghostbusters 2. Hey, are you going to play in the Super Mario Brothers? In the late 80s, that's really where starting to make references and parodies of existing properties started becoming a thing. So here in the early 90s, a little too soon to get in on the market of just parody.
And they did a lot of parody. Every episode starts out with the phone call, and then the ones that I remember, I specifically remember Cliffhanger, because it was like a bunch of animals all the way down, and then like a mouse holding a piece of cheese. And there was a Jurassic Park one, I believe. They all started to run together.
Yeah, let me bring in the supercut. I got a lot. 21 minutes in this supercut of all the references. As I said, I did miss the ones in LAJ where they had a Scent of a Woman and a Ghostbusters parody with an 80-foot Ed Koch. So those two aren't in this supercut.
That's right. What was this phrase he was saying?
How am I doing?
Yeah. How am I doing?
So those were two parodies that we won't be seeing in this. And this little film parody, they did have a different phone gag for every single episode. They didn't have a different one for every single episode. But the very first episode here, we have an Aliens parody.
It stinks. Home Alone 5.
Still in the first episode.
I love the fact that he ran out of spray, so he had to grab her hat because he's bald. That's his makeup lady's hat.
World's greatest granny. Doris is another. This show has very, very rich side characters. Duke Phillips, I have quite a few clips of. I don't think I pulled any of Doris, but those are just two of the fun little side characters. Let's play one of Duke here, having some contempt for Jay. Am I sharing the right one?
Hey, that's my chair.
We're cutting back. Just three more sponsors.
You can't be taking my chair to save money.
All right, I'm taking it to spite your low-rated, Spielberg-hating, toilet-seat-destroying butt.
Don't listen to him, my pet.
So cutting his budget, and the chair isn't even part of the budget cuts. It's just because, fuck you, while we're cutting your budget, this I'm putting this under the umbrella of budget cuts, even though it doesn't make a bit of difference.
Yeah, Duke is not friendly to Jay Sherman at all. He pulls a contract at one point. Oh, no, he tells Jay Sherman to dance, and Jay turns and says to him, I think my contract says prance. And then he turns to the drawer and pulls the contract. He's like, you win this time, Sherman.
Yeah, you see his face get very cringy, very upset. You're right. Your prancing is in your contract. And that leads to actually the drop that I have on my board regularly when I have a bomb of a joke.
Where's the joke?
Sir, we're on the air.
I know we're on the air, but where's the joke?
And why aren't you prancing? That's, he adds in there as genius. Well.
That's that was right out. That's the next line.
And he's it's after Jay makes a very shitty joke. Well, it's more of a bone moo. Run, don't mosey to see the tea cozy, which then triggers him on air to say, where's the joke? And here we see some more contempt that Duke Phillips has for Jay Sherman as the studio is on fire.
Help!
What a wimp. Why?
You were whacked out on painkillers for your back.
Oh, yeah. That was the same week I bought those pandas. Hong Ping, don't eat daddy's Picasso.
And we get a few instances of Duke with some wild animals. This is a Ted Turner parody, which is once again like an early predicting the future with the changing films with AI, the Duke Vision that he has Duke going Vision. On.
Yes.
Which was a parody of Ted Turner colorizing every film under the planet. Once again, predicting the future with Duke Vision of not just colorizing classics, but putting in endings that he would rather see. And while we're on the wild animals, here's Duke getting upset about some more wild animals.
You want to see an absolute disgrace? Come up to see my room. I ordered white tigers.
I love the dejectedness of the tigers. They just know that they're being shat on.
Awful. There's a bear.
The dancing bear, also has a range of emotion as well of really being sad. We get more emotions out of the dancing bear. Unfortunately, I didn't grab any of those clips. But another example of Duke with wild animals. The bear was he was trying to country up the coming attractions show. And the animal rights people would not allow a stuffed bear, so it was just a doped up real bear.
Standing in the corner just nod it out.
Clearly, Maurice LaMarche's voice doing the.
Oh yeah, he's all over this. One of my favorite voice actors, and not just because of the Orson Welles.
He's become one of the biggest voice actors around. Another regular on Futurama, Mr. Freeze, and several other in the Arkham series. And he's one of those, like, it took me a while to nail down what voices Maurice LaMarche does, because he does have a wide range.
Yeah, he's very good. And if you guys get a chance, go YouTube him doing Columbo. It's really, really good.
And I do have another clip of Duke making the Expendables before the Expendables was a thing. This was another thing.
I'm glad you brought that up.
That really made me laugh. What was Duke's remake was actually the Expendables before Sylvester Stallone made it happen.
You know that Dirty Dozen remake I'm producing?
Is that Schwarzenegger movie?
Yeah, he's in it. And Stallone, Bruce Willis, and Eddie Murphy, and Michael Caine. Can't make a move without Michael Caine.
Is it good?
It's 5 hours of mind-numbing crap. But you have to go on the air and say it's the best thing you've ever seen.
Hey, this is my integrity we're talking about.
Hey, look, boy, I'm in this deep. Do you know how much it cost to get Saddam Hussein to play himself? I had to give him a whole mess of Tomahawk missiles. And once he got them, Stallone wanted them, Schwarzenegger wanted them.
Yo, Maria, check this out. No deposit, no return.
Cornball. I loved it. That was such a good clip.
And he went all out to get Saddam Hussein to play himself rather than just the guy from Hot Shots Part 2, who was perfectly fine.
Oh, yeah. That was a good movie as well. Speaking of parody movies, I liked both Hot Shots and I think Scary Movie 2. If I watch that again, I'll probably not like it as much. But I remember liking that one a lot.
Scary Movie 2 is right there on the fence of where the parody movies of like the Zucker Brothers, I think they were involved in Hot Shots. I don't recall if that was a Zucker Brothers or not, but it certainly felt like their fun Naked Gun style of movie. The one joke I remember the most is there's actually a ticker of a body count in Hot Shots Part 2. And at one point, I think it's Charlie Sheen picks up bullets and throws them at people, and the body count goes up. Official bloodiest movie ever. Ding, ding, ding.
Yes.
Before we get away from Duke Phillips, I forget what this clip is that's labeled Duke In and Out. But since we're on the Duke Phillips, I would like to get in some more Duke Phillips because I think he's my favorite of all the characters.
Hello, Jay.
How did you get in?
I have my ways. I'll show myself out.
That's what that clip was. He, cartoon character, makes a hole of himself.
Exactly.
He didn't even go out the same hole that he had. He made a brand new hole for himself to go out when he just made another one. And actually, this clip I have here of Duke is reminiscent of one of the very first Simpson jokes of Quidgy-bo, the Simpsons.
Oh, the Scrabble word.
Yeah, the Scrabble word that Bart makes up, a Quidgy-bo, and he just describes Homer as an ape to describe what a Quidgy-bo is. And Quidgy-bo must have been on Al Jean and Mike Reese's mind because they then make up another very similar word.
Quizzabuck.
That's not a word.
Quizzabuck.
Get Webster on the phone. Noah, how you doing? It's Duke. How much would it cost to make Quizzabuck a word? I don't know what it means. How about a big problem? Great. How about that other word I invented? Dukelicious. No one's using it. What a Duke-tastrophe.
And what's fun, this is the episode where Duke Phillips has a terminal disease, and the doctor later uses Quizzabuck to describe the situation that he's in. So Quizzabuck does indeed make it around, unlike Duke-tastrophe.
Oh, Duke-tastrophe. That's such a good word.
And yes, here's one more clip I have from the episode where Duke believes he's dying. He goes to Dr. Kevorkian, and Jay convinces Duke, no, don't tap out yet. Let's give this another shot. And we have Dr. Kevorkian's reaction to losing a patient. Losing, of course, being the opposite for Kevorkian.
Yeah. I've never lost a patient before.
You can still run him down in the parking lot.
To the Deathmobile!
Nice. That's always a great gag.
A shitty Deathmobile. Yeah, we've seen that gag before, but it works very well when done properly, as it did here, of being afraid for Duke for just a quick second.
And he's looking at them with disdain now, too, just like, what were you thinking? He can walk through Rawls. That car's not going to do anything to him.
Right.
And I don't hear this voice actor in a lot of other things. I did look up Charles Napier. Either of you guys look up the voice behind Duke Phillips?
No, I did not.
Yeah, he's in the Blues Brothers. He's the low rent Brian Dennehy.
He's one of the quintessential that guy actors to such a degree. Yes. Tommy, you and I talked about him last episode on the Cable Guy.
Are you serious? It's that guy?
It's the arresting officer of Matthew Broderick, the Cable Guy.
You did talk about him.
Dude.
You totally did.
Stephen Kovacs, you're under arrest. God damn it. I didn't even catch it.
I didn't realize it was him either. He's putting a certain spin on his voice.
He's got that little bit more of a southern twang here now.
Yeah, he puts on a more of a southern twang. But yeah, it's the guy from the he's in the Blues Brothers. He's the
Hannibal Lecter ate his face. He's such a guy actor. We've now talked
that's
about
what
him
we were
twice.
Talking about Hannibal Lecter eating his face off. Okay.
So I believe that's all the clips I have of Duke Phillips. And yeah, that was quite fun to find out that our buddy Charles Napier, such a that guy actor, popped up two episodes in a row.
Funny. That's really funny.
Yeah, that was actually my goal in Hollywood, was to be a that guy. Because you don't want to be super famous. Like Michael Jackson, one of his birthdays, he paid a bunch of people in the grocery store to just not acknowledge him so he could be a normal person. And just the pains in the ass of everyone either loving you or hating you and wanting to bother you. But being a that guy, like Charles Napier, where you don't know if he arrested Matthew Broderick, you don't know if he was your study buddy in college, you know him somewhere.
Right.
And now we'll go back to the parody supercut, because this is this was the show's strongest point, was the parodies. And we'll get back to some of the characters in a little bit. Home Alone 5 here we have. And I do believe there are 5 Home Alones now. They just eventually went with another kid that wasn't as cute as Macaulay Culkin.
Yeah.
We left Kevin home alone, and he's only 23!
It's the story of a Chicago...
It's the cigarette falling out of his mouth. It helps helps that joke more.
Oh, yeah. That's, you know, he's still living at home. He's 23. Smoking.
And irresponsible. Yeah, we're still here in the first episode. They front-loaded this. There are some episodes that only have like 1 or 2 movie parodies, but they front-loaded this first episode with the movie parodies, because that's really what...
Go ahead. I'm sorry. I mean
that. I was going to say that's really what got them on the air. That was the selling point. So sometimes when they focus more on plot, which, as I mentioned, wasn't their strong point, the plot... Oh, that's actually another thing you guys missed from L.A.J. when he talks to a Hollywood executive about a plot, and like the executive never heard that word before. Plot. Plot, 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 plot.
Yeah, they don't know. They don't know what that word means.
The cop who goes.
not at all. They know what money means, and sometimes that fucking plot gets in the way. But it didn't get in the way of Arnold Schwarzenegger playing a detective undercover as a Hasidic Jew.
Was undercover as a Hasidic Jew.
John Lovitz talking.
Eat lead, Rabbi.
Sorry, that's not kosher. All right. If you are a real rabbi, circumcise this child.
That is a clever death gag there. He's exposed that he has no moil abilities, but he is going to stab him through the heart with his moil knife.
Jeez. That's that. It was too much for me.
No, I thought that was a great gag. That's great. That's perfect.
Clever deaths are what was missing from the first Winnie the Pooh Blood and Honey. There's just nothing clever about that movie whatsoever. I'm curious about the second one. I know they've got a bigger budget. And according to the scroll in the first one, Owl and Rabbit are around somewhere, so maybe they got a mask for Owl and Rabbit, but there's just absolutely nothing clever about that movie whatsoever. Not a single fun death. You get some boobies before they get thrown in the wood chipper, and there is one good moment in Blood and Honey towards the end that almost redeems the entire movie. One of the last deaths, I actually did cheer for one death, as I'm shitting on Blood and Honey for not being as clever as this parody of a Moyle stabbing a guy with his Moyle knife. And they do have some fun with these parodies, whereas, I've actually heard the Blood and Honey director kind of gatekeeping, kind of like, you know, you got to have certain things, where his execution was pretty poor. Have you guys seen that movie yet? The horror?
No, I honestly thought that was a parody. I did not know that was a real movie.
No, I haven't seen it either.
It's a thing. During the very beginning and the boobies going in the wood chipper. Oh, actually, there is a fun death of a TikToker where they crush her head with a car. Few and far between for me to give that a thumbs up. I've got to give it the old Jay Sherman. It stinks.
Sounds like it.
And they've got a sequel. So I'm curious if it stinks less.
Avanagila, baby.
Dreidel, I made you out of clay.
I'm sorry, I just didn't think you made a very...
So that was our first action movie parody. They really love shitting on Stallone and Schwarzenegger throughout this series.
Yeah,
they get him a couple times.
The LAJ episode also has a silhouette of Arnold taking off his muscles like a jacket at night. No one must know.
I think they should have played up the fact that obviously this person comes from Jewish parents, but his adopted parents were the biggest wasps ever to exist in the history of waspiness. I think they should have played that up, because I don't know why, but when he said Arnold Schwarzenegger plays a Hasidic Jew, like, the way he says that just made me laugh. And I always thought in the show they should have played that up more for gags, because that would have been funny.
In the adoption episode, his assistant Doris, they believe that she might be his mother, and they go to the adoption agency.
Right, that's right.
And very much like a genie with questions. He can ask three questions about his adoptive parents. Am I Jewish? And it's like, fucking duh.
Yeah, that's what he says. He goes, "What do you think?" And then Jay stands up and starts us. And then Jay wishes for $1 million. And then the priest goes, "I'm a priest and not a genie."
Not a genie.
And he's like, "All right, one more question left." And then I forget what he asked.
But he did get the home game of who are my parents.
Four questions. Here's the home game.
Yeah, he did count the wish as a question. He, even though it was a wish, he counted that as a question. And that was very reminiscent of Homer and Apu going to the number one quickie mart in India. You may have three questions. Are you really the head of the quickie mart? Really? Really? Thank you. Come again. When the whole point was to get Apu his job back, and he wasted the opportunity on two reallys.
Oh, geez.
But since we talked about the waspy parents, Franklin, the father, the adopted father, was another one of my favorite characters.
He's a great character.
He was the best character, I feel.
Yeah, we went through the Duke clips. I think as a kid, I liked Franklin more. In the rewatch, I'm a bigger fan of Duke, but still absolutely love Franklin. So here's Franklin just being, I think he was a mayor. They mentioned that he was a mayor at one point. And that's right, he's talking to a judge. Didn't I appoint you? No, you appointed Mr. Potato Head. The voters recalled him.
Yeah, he gets into all kinds of hijinks like that.
And so apparently he was a crazy person when he was in office. This isn't something that happened with age. as we see 15 years ago, he was still a very absent-minded person with younger Jay asking him some questions.
Dad, you've always been sort of like a father to me. What do you think I should do with my life?
Oh, that's a good question, son. Now, here's one for you. They're called fingers, and yet they don't fing. Noodle that one for a while.
And he just walks off after giving him that sage advice of not finging.
They don't fing.
A funny line too went right by us. Dad, you've been like a father to me, which is also accurate. He's been like a father since he's been his adopted father.
Yes, exactly. I like those. Those are the type of lines that on a rewatch, you know, you catch it like, oh, that's pretty clever.
Yeah, yeah. A quick, fun dialogue that the producers of Date Movie do not have that have taken what the Zucker brothers built up and the Wayans gave them some clout for in the Scary Movie series that they then have that bastardized into fucking garbage.
And speaking of Scary Movie too, that's one of the lines I remember was David Cross was in a wheelchair and he says, okay, I'm going to run upstairs and jump into my jogging suit. And I was laughing my ass off because he's in a wheelchair. He doesn't not going to run upstairs. He's not jumping into a jogging suit, you know? And so that one always kind of stuck with me as well. Just a clever, silly, sneak it in there line.
One of the things that Scary Movie 2 might not be as good with is how topical it was.
Got
so topical. David Cross's character in the wheelchair wipes out, and then they show him the wheelchair on the ground with the Firestone tires spinning, which was very funny at the time. And then you're just like, what the fuck is that? Airplane does have that too, with Jim never has two cups of coffee at home.
See, like, they parody a commercial, and that's what in Scary Movie, the commercial they parody is a Nike one where it's like basketball. So, and that I was like,
that's what I was going to mention about the Critic too. There's a lot of like 90s gags that I don't feel like carry over.
I agree with that. There's many, and I we'll get to, there's a lot of vaudeville style of jokes that don't really get to carry into a younger audience right now. And a lot of character references. Like, people, who the hell knows who Dudley Moore is anymore?
Right.
Yeah, Dudley Moore, I'm still very aware, but then again, I'm 37. I've got to say it that way because of Clerks. So, believe it or not,
I'm 38.
Hey, you, get back here.
Such a good movie.
And actually a lot of Clerks dialogue, they have movie references that do stand up because Star Wars still fucking popular. So Airplane, as I mentioned, with their coffee reference gag, very few and far between that do not stand the test of time. Airplane made in what, 1979, 1980? Almost all their jokes do stand up to the test of time. Whereas, as we not as many with the Critic, and then it seems as we get more to modern times, that there's more jokes that are going to be funny in the moment and then never again when you watch it in 20 years. Yeah.
But then at the same time, there are a lot of visual gags that will hold up. Jay Sherman's ex-wife lives in Alimony Towers.
Oh, she is so defeated. We do not see much of Jay Sherman's ex-wife, but she is just like soulless. That marriage took the life out of her. And that's one of the things I wish we would have got more, like a B plot with Marty and the dad and the stepmom. because Marty, the son of Jay Sherman, shows up a couple of times, but for the most part, he's just kind of there. He shows up, yeah. And then a lot of episodes, he's just not there. He's there, and he's not there. So, yeah, that's something like a B plot. Actually, I should get to. I've currently got another Franklin clip looming over, so I'll play that one before we get too far into Marty.
Oh yeah.
Good news, son. I found the perfect mate for you. Her name is Barbie, and she's from Malibu. Now, she has a boyfriend named Ken, but he's not much of a man. I checked.
From the Fat Little Pig episode. As I mentioned, I felt that was the superior of the two episodes that were very similar of Jay and his mom having problems. And she wrote a kid's storybook, The Fat Little Pig, based on Jay and everyone that made fun of Jay, even more so than usual. This one is a real fun gag. Being that they were the lead-in for Home Improvement, they got in a few Home Improvement gags, including getting some advice from the neighbor Wilson.
Oh, Wilson, my wife is happy again. My wife, Eleanor. 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 My wife, Eleanor.
And also going with the Home Improvement gag of that type of strange, unique dissolve into the next scene. There was a frog there earlier that his advice, what should my wife do? Ribbit. So he got her to rivet, which did not get her to overcome her depression.
And they do a crazy glue gag when mm-hmm. they're up on the thing, right? He's glued to it, like, oh, you blah, 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 with the crazy glue. Just kick my leg.
And it's crazy.
And then they do the circle close on his face. Franklin reminds me of the father from Soap, which is like a 70s sitcom from back in the day, if you remember.
Haven't seen it myself. I remember it being...
General or something?
Yes, he was the general. He came back from the war. And he was just, at the term I believe they used at the time was like shell shock. And he would get lost and he was doing things. And this is the show that spawned Benson, which is in the little later of the 80s. Benson was the butler for the family and they're very much like this family. It was a very rich, waspy family. And Mona from Who's the Boss? Is the matriarch, and then her husband is the patriarch of the one family, and they're living with the old military dad.
Crystal is in there somewhere, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, Crystal was the gay son in that show.
Yes, he was dating a football quarterback who was closeted gay, and Billy Crystal was going to get a trans operation. And this is a show in the 70s that's parodying. Yeah. Soap operas from the time. So everything's super exaggerated. And what I remember as a kid, there was another guy who had a puppet. He had it wasn't Charlie McCarthy, but it was similar in style, but dressed exactly like the ventriloquist. And he was another crazy person in the family. It's a really great show.
Yes.
I'm going to have to check that out. It was
a comedy. Oh my God. You had to watch it. It was a comedy. But it was in the vein of a soap opera. So there were gags and it was funny, but there was no laugh track. So you're watching this.
Straight.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's where Leslie Nielsen did a lot of his best work, just playing it completely straight. Like the doctor in Airplane wasn't winking at the camera. He did have some goofball stuff in Naked Gun, but a lot of it was just him playing it completely straight.
Yeah, and that's what makes it really good, too. And that's kind of what this show is. Did you ever see the sitcom Empty Nest?
No, that one's off my radar as well.
I can't remember the actor's name,
but he looks like Leslie Nielsen. I used to get them confused as a kid.
Oh, I think I know who you're talking about.
He looks somewhat similar.
He's the bad guy from Inner Space, right?
Yes.
And UHF.
That's right.
Silver hair.
No,
No,
that's a different actor. The guy is he was in that Blake Edwards movie, SOB.
I don't think I've seen that.
Yeah, no, it's Bert was the character's name on Bert, Soap. Yeah. He was the doctor in that show Empty Nest, but it's not Kevin McCarthy.
Oh, okay. Okay, see, you know who it is. All right. But I know I'm talking about too. That's another one
for
of those.
Sure, totally. Yeah.
You catch him around, or he might just show up. And then it was one more quick thing about this. There's a lot of fourth wall breaks that Jay does in this cartoon that was kind of a put off. Not a lot, but there's at least two I know for sure of in the first season where he looks straight at the camera and does a thing. And in an animated show, that kind of is, I don't like it.
Yeah, but it's become kind of a staple in animated shows now.
What I do love in an animated show is just pure goofiness, and we have one more of Franklin being goofy here.
I don't want to go to your school.
You have to go. We've given them so much money. They even have a statue of your father.
There's a reason there's a banana in my ear. I'm trying to lure the monkey out of my head.
He's been wearing that underwear on his head for so long, the statue just includes it.
I wrote this joke down specific because it's so funny to me. There's a reason the banana's in my ear. I'm trying to get the monkey out of my head. And that's why, that's what reminds me of Soap, because it's silly stuff like that, you know? And he never gets breakfast right Benson never gets breakfast right for him. And that's the gag in Soap. And he always has some ridiculous reason of why nothing's ever good enough. And, you know, Benson's black and it's 1970 and he's from the 40s. So there's a little bit of racial humor that's in there, but Benson holds his own.
We do have the butler in this show. That's yeah, basically also a crotchety old white man that has contempt for the entire family. The initial book before Jay's mom wrote The Fat Little Pig. She wrote an essay on why poor people should be blasted into the sun. And then the butler is just wiping his ass, doing a little dance on her plate. And Franklin, of course, he just does that. He sees the butler and the butler gets like an oh shit look. But I thought I was the only one again. Starts singing a song while doing a butt dance on the.
That's what makes Franklin a good character right there. He's ready to join. He's the best yes and in the show.
And when Jay brought his laundry for the butler to do, somehow it caught on fire. Like he gets a stick. if he can find a stick long enough, he'll do the laundry. And somehow it caught on fire.
Why is it burning for so long? I think that's another Maurice LaMarche character too. I'm not 100%. It might not be.
I don't have any of the butler speaking, so he can't check that. But yeah, he is very diverse. Someone, and speaking of known voice actresses, Nancy Cartwright, Bart Simpson, is Margot, his sister here. The episode with Margot's debutante ball was one of my favorite in this first season. And even though they did a lot of telling rather than showing of the relationship with Margot and Jay, I kind of wanted more of that, of the dynamic of Jay and his sister, because it did have as I said, told us and didn't show us how much they mean to each other. There was some heart in that debutante episode.
Yeah.
That's his only real ally and was growing up, you know, even though he's the older brother. She offers him real moral support. And that was another thing I noticed about this whole season. At least in the first half of the first season, it's a real woe is me beating Jay down. He wasn't getting laid. He's ugly, blah, blah, blah. But by the fifth and sixth episode, I think he was on two other dates. One was Misery.
The whole episode of the Misery parody. Oh, did I pull that? Actually, that's in the supercut. We'll watch a little bit more of the supercut. And Tubi had it listed as the second episode. It was actually the third episode aired. So we should be getting to the Misery parody clip in just a moment here as we revisit the strongest part of the show, the parodies.
by convincing Mahatma.
I will bring peace between the Hindu and the Muslim. But first,
Jeremy Hawk, his best friend and sexy actor, playing sexy Mahatma Gandhi.
First, a tasteful glimpse of me bottom for the ladies.
This is something they had from the Simpsons as well, the parody of video games of the time. So, Escape from New York.
Tickets to get to Long Island.
Uh-oh, Yankee Stadium is emptying out.
And it's Nickel Beer Day.
Nickel Beer Day.
It's Nickel Beer Day.
Dallas Sharpton.
And that really was a thing, a Nickel Beer Day. There is a YouTuber that covered Nickel Beer Day and the fallout. And I think they actually did it twice, and it was fucking disaster both times. And American Cupcake quoting this finishing move, this fatality from Al Sharpton.
Blah, 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 blah,
yep.
Blah, 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 blah.
A story told through time.
The first episode, as mentioned earlier, this actress was seducing Jay to get a good review, and he had to be honest to himself. She stunk in the movie. Here, the night before, they're having a nice little Beauty and the Beast dance.
Happening in New York. He's a lemon, she's a lime. Beauty and King Dork.
King Dork, established earlier in the episode, was graffitied onto his car, so bringing it back for this song parody.
He's Adam to Harry. She's Mindy to his Mark. Her hair's like silk, he's Hadaway.
Beauty and King Dork.
What did you say?
We'll be reviewing Family Affair.
The toilet, doing the singing. A very fun choice. Just adds a little comedy there.
And that scene... real quick, that scene when they were doing the dancing and it was his imagination, that was a 3D rendered background.
And it didn't look like horribly out of place either.
Right.
They must have done the strategy that both Futurama and the Iron Giant did of making the CGI have like a squiggle, as they say, some imperfections.
Yeah, some outline, yeah.
And that's how they made it look not completely out of space. Like the Anastasia music box looks completely out of place because they didn't give it that little imperfection squiggle.
Yeah.
Just look who got $8 million to play Mr. French.
Buffy, Zodi.
Superman reference there.
Peanut butter and banana sandwiches.
Would you make a sandwich for my doll, Mrs. Beasley?
Yeah, sure. That's exactly what I feel like doing. Of course I can get together a little sandwich for your stupid little doll. Hang on a sec.
I thought you would take your candy out tonight.
And they actually bring that gag back. If we get to the end of this supercut, they have Marlon Brando. Again, they really love that gag of he doesn't care. You're going to pay him all these millions of dollars. As with the Island of Dr. Moreau, he didn't fucking care. He drove that director insane.
God, that movie.
If you hear the behind the scenes of what was going on is more fascinating than the movie itself, the Island of Dr. Moreau TV movie. He drove that director literally insane.
Oh yeah, him and Val Kilmer both.
Val Kilmer too was a horrible.
Yeah, not unbearable. So the one guy that's like the lead actor hated being there with both of them. Marlon Brando just does what he wants.
Yeah, he showed up for Superman for a day, got paid millions of dollars, and got a percentage. I believe I saw that it was, if it was modern times, it would have been $78 million he got for his one day on set for adjusted for inflation. So many millions back in, what was it, 78, 81 when Superman was made, and adjusted for inflation, basically $78 million for a day's work for being on Superman. And yeah, we're still, here in the first episode with these parodies. As I mentioned, they front-loaded this one a lot with the selling point of the parodies.
Why do they call
it? They wanted you to know.
I took her to a restaurant. It wasn't out, it was in. I would say I'm taking her in, but then she sounds like a pair of pants.
Edward, plunge your hands.
Please shoot me.
Hello, I'm William Shatner, and this is Celebrity Autopsy.
That was a good one, too. Sweet.
Edward Plunderhands, not to be confused with Edwina Windshield Wiper Hands, who I am a big simp for over on TikTok. I love when she comes up in the algorithm. And here's what we were talking about, the Misery episode. And they got in a few Honey, I Shrunk the Kids references. Here is the first one of what they get in. And Luigi Greenberg has seen that documentary on the island of Dr. Moreau. Fascinating. Absolutely. Stuff that was going on there. So here, what did Rick Moranis do to the kids?
Dart, have you seen Timmy, Becky, and Alex?
You're going to be really mad at me.
Oh, no. What did you do this time?
Honey, I laminated the kids.
Okay, so here we've got the Misery lady running away. Jeremy Hawk has tracked her down, and we've got a bit of a car chase and a fun little parody in the middle here.
Dude, I love that taxi. That was so good.
Such a fun little and that's actually another thing. In grade school, I knew of Taxi. I was watching Nick at Night, but other people my age were very unaware of Reverend Jim and Lotka. So yeah,
Lotka was a good character, even for kids. You know, you would watch it for him alone.
When I was a kid, I watched it for Lotka. Like I'm about 10 years older than you guys. So, I mean, my folks watched, like, my mom watched that show, like, as it aired.
And I'm a fan of Bob James, too, who did the Angela's Theme, is the title of the theme.
Yeah, Angela's Theme was supposed to be the theme of Angela, who was a phone operator Alex Rieger went out with, turned out to be a very unattractive lady, and he gave her a chance, even though, like, she came to the date. All right, you see me, you don't want me. No, I'm going to give you a chance. So that was actually supposed to be a one-off for an episode that they were like, no, we actually like this as the theme better. And really fun being inserted there in the middle of a car chase.
Yeah, because it's a slow jam, you know? It's not
right.
It's not car chase music at all.
And here is the Misery parody, the end of it that we were speaking of. Those who have seen Misery know at the end of the restaurant, James Caan just starts seeing Kathy Bates everywhere when he sees a fan. So he's just traumatized and gets scared anytime he sees a super fan of him. Here, JC sees same idea. He sees her out in public.
Jay. I can't believe you asked me out on a second date.
I know you tried to kill me, but you did have sex with me. That puts you a little ahead in my book.
Spike Lee's newest.
So literally sees her, and she's getting a second chance because Jay is up for some more sex.
And she hands him a bottle of wine, and he gives him the
That's what knocked him out the first time was the bottle of wine. And later, we get Jay being seduced by another woman, and his mother has a very fun line. Oh, I do hope she sleeps with him before she kills him.
She hits him with a lot of good one-liners, a lot of real punches.
But the that was a B plot, actually, in the debutante episode, the B plot of the Humphrey the Hippo, the Barney the Dinosaur parody that's beating Jay in the ratings. And the lady underneath Humphrey the Hippo has a thing for Jay.
Yeah.
And she gets in a one liner, too. How could someone so incompetent at sex be so relaxed?
I love those. Those are so good.
But
oh, and there was an audio gag too. You hear an extra long zipper, like she was getting out of the dinosaur suit, but it's him taking his pants off.
Yeah, she had the bottoms right on. Oh, it was a Crying Game parody where she was like, I don't think you're going to like what you see. I've got a terrible secret down here. And it's not a penis. It is the dinosaur pants. That yeah, then the audio gag of like, oh, she's zip. Nope, that was Jay's zipper.
Yep.
I've never seen the Crying Game.
I have never seen it, but pop culture ruin.
Yep. Yeah, I was just gonna say, yeah, it was one of those movies that you kind of you know the plot.
I think it was The Simpsons ruined it for me. He just straight out, Mayor Quimby just says it randomly at some point.
That's right.
White does recommend The Crying Game, though. But yeah, that twist was ruined the first time I heard of The Crying Game, thanks to Mayor Quimby.
Yeah, I know. Great. From a cartoon, you know, leads you down the line. That was something else about this show, The Critic. Some of the references are for like an older audience, and some of the gags are definitely for juvenile men, which I appreciate.
Yeah.
And I do like, I've been saying for a while, still at this age, I've got like a middle school type of sense of humor. That's why Stern was so appealing, that he can, he was able to do some highbrow and some middle school stuff at the same time to appeal to both parts of my brain. And I'm sorry, Mr. Blue Sky, we'll try to keep it down while you're sleeping, but only for a moment.
Oh, Mr. Blue Sky. I only respect him because of the hours and hours of music that he has.
Yeah, just throw on some of your music. That's some very relaxing music.
It is. It's really good.
It doesn't fit in with any of the dancing segments on TikTok or on the clock, but I do enjoy putting those ambient type tracks of Mr. Blue Sky where they are appropriate. There is one that I put in the dance mix. But yeah, very chill style from Mr. Blue Sky. And I've got another clip of Jay. He likes to pretend that he has an assistant to make himself seem The Crying Game is not a woke movie. Yeah, I kind of
No, it's not.
Yeah, we were assuming that based on what we do know about the big twist. But Bernt White definitely talking it up very much. We will even with the twist, he says we've got to check that out. Jay Sherman, very much like Saul Goodman, pretends he has an assistant to make himself seem bigger than he is. And getting off on the still on the Crying Game. Luigi Greenberg knows the exact quote. Oh, yeah, that chick in The Crying Game is really a man.
There's a show I was watching. It's called Snuffbox, and there's a guy that's dating a woman who's really a man, and she tells him, I'm really a man, and they're having all this good time. They're drinking beers. She's really putting down the beers and eating pizza in bed. And she goes, so I thought you would really have a problem that I used to be a man. And then he goes, what? I thought you said you were from Iran. Like, and then it just completely changes. Like, he just hates her from now on after that. It takes all sorts to make the world go round. Maybe we'll get to cover that in the future, hopefully, because there's only one season.
That does fit in with the format. Be sure to make a note of that. I might forget it by the end of the episode. But there's actually a joke like that in the subway where Jay is thinking in his head. I forget what his question is. I wonder if he can tell blah, blah, blah.
Is this my chance meeting? Is this the one? Does she know? And then they cut to the woman.
I wonder if he knows that I'm really a man.
Yeah, there's some of those. See, that's what I mean. Like, and this was on ABC in the 90s. So, you know, that's even back then, that was still the family channel and owned by Disney, I believe.
Yeah, well,
Disney acquired it, I believe, sometime in the 90s. I believe this was after the Disney acquisition, if I remember the timeline correctly.
I gotta go. I would have to look that one up. And now, yeah, they were already a big
two of the networks, and is somehow not a monopoly. So, hooray for Disney!
Fucking bricks.
But as I was setting up crying game got me distracted again, Jay pretends to have an assistant, and they carry out that joke for a little while on this one.
Let me check with my assistant and see if I'm free. Oh, Ethel, am I free for the theater this evening?
You certainly are. Why don't you take Miss Sharon Stone? She's sweet on you, boss.
Really? Sharon Stone? You heard me. Sharon Stone. I'd like you to meet Ethel, but she just jumped out the window.
Just take the bloody tickets.
Oh, why don't you ever let me meet your friends?
Because the last time I did, you spilled coffee on Mr. Al Jolson. Ethel, you're spilling coffee on me. I'm begging you, put down the percolator, honey lamb.
So Jay appears to be legit schizophrenic, as even after he's caught by someone pretending to be another person, he's going to keep on going with that gag. And let me say the proper quote now that Luigi Greenberg got a retraction there. Cool. In other news, the chick in the crying game is really a man. And then the crowd boos him and he says something else.
Oh, and I was wrong. It was the IT crowd that bit was from.
Burnt White is on it today.
Got me. That's right. I got the right actor, wrong show. Todd Barry is this the guy. He's guy. I'm sorry.
So back to our supercut. I'm actually going to jump ahead a little. Oh, the Red Balloon Part 2.
This was good, too.
I watched the Red Balloon in grade school. They showed this to us. So I was aware of this reference when this came out. And it's just an artsy French film about a kid trying to get back his red balloon that Jay is so excited. All right, we're going to see the Red Balloon Part 2, Revenge of the Balloon.
Machi, machi!
One more step and the red balloon becomes the dead balloon.
All the diehard terrorists are now after the red balloon.
I could not have foreseen that.
Oh, yeah, it says date.
I can't afford to have that balloon fall into the wrong hands.
I don't know who's full of more hot air, General. That balloon or you?
Steven Seagal there.
He was actually... Oh, yeah, he was actually in shape. That's how long ago this was.
Yeah, when he actually stood in movies, he didn't just sit down and put on his whatever accent that he's trying to do now.
Right, dude. I fucking cannot stand Steven Seagal.
Still people over in African and Indian countries that are willing to pay him a whole bunch of money to sit down in a chair and ramble on. Isn't there a Steven Seagal Mike Tyson movie made in from one of the stands, I believe? There's still people willing to give him money.
Good God, man. Yeah, I know. I know what you know. He's been sitting down in all of his sniper movies for the last 20 years. One room. He's Marlon Brando-ish.
Yes, he's Marlon Brando just sitting down, doing whatever the fuck he wants, and nowhere near as big of a name. Not making the $78 million, but still making like $2 million for a couple of days of work.
Such a fraud, though. He's such a fraud.
Yeah, he's a big faker. Hello,
doggy.
I'm gonna mute. Worried about my dog barking this time.
Yes, this is actually the doggy over here. I'm going to play some of the parody clips while I get her to shut up.
He's going to go full Nixon.
Right.
Today, I consider myself the luckiest guy in the whole wide world.
Lou, me and the boys have been working on a cure. We call it Lou Gehrig's oil.
Strength returning. Lou Gehrig's disease in remission. Hey.
And this actually isn't Duke Vision. This is just new producers coming in with Pride of the Yankees to make it a happier movie.
Must be a fat one.
And Bill Cosby born!
And thanks to you, Bambino, I'll live to see his warm, unthreatening comedy.
Wow! That was such a... well at all.
And speaking of the miracle oil, I do have the ending of... wrong one. Jay's oil that he made for Duke Phillips to cure Duke Phillips syndrome. So here's all the lives that Jay's oil saved.
I'm Jim Bob Huggins, and I was cured by Jay's oil.
I'm Lars Schoenberg, and I just clubbed my 1,000th baby seal thanks to Jay's oil.
I'm a drunken tanker captain. I wouldn't be able to spill my oil without Jay's oil.
Your streets will run red with blood thanks to Jay's oil.
Sherman Uber Alles.
We love you, Jay.
We love you, man.
Yeah.
Jay Awful. Sherman saved all those lives with his oil. And I also pulled this visual gag of the hamster that he cures with Duke Phillips disease. Made me laugh as well. Somehow sneezing was the secret ingredient he was missing.
I did it! Oh, I'm a doc! A happy, sneezy doc. Ooh, I'm a sleepy, happy, sneezy doc. If I don't get to bed, I'll be a grumpy, dopey, sleepy, happy, sneezy doc. Bashful?
Actually, along the lines of all those lives that Jay saved, we have Jay went to the Cannes Film Festival, and there was a local who doesn't like what Cannes has become. He reminisces over the good times.
The tourists have ruined Cannes. When I was a boy, the people were friendly, and the beach was beautiful.
Monsieur Hitler, my tie.
You need a tail. Use mine armband.
Oh, no, Edol.
Oh, Schnitzy. Good boy. Jawohl.
I mean, you will be having wine with your meal?
Oh, that's the awful.
Someone was a fan of The Occupation.
Yeah, no kidding.
Wasn't there? There was a movie called I think it was Moon Over Parador. It was about all the Nazis that fled to Argentina in South America.
They all took U-boats and they fled.
Yeah.
Now it's super conspiracy theory.
The Simpsons even has a joke of old Hitler in Argentina. The Australia episode, Bart's prank calling Argentina.
That's right, and he answers.
Yeah, there's old Hitler who doesn't get to his phone. Well, no,
there are Germans in Argentina. Like I don't know if you guys are familiar with that show Sábado Gigante on Univision, on Univision.
Yeah.
The guy Don Francisco, the host of that show. His real name is Mario Katzenberger.
Yep. Carlos Mencia is Ned something else. And he's half German. He's literally like half German from Honduras. He's Honduras and German.
Louis C.K. is a Mexican.
That's right. You know, Louis Beans.
Oh, Louis Beans.
So, wait, I got a quick question. So American Cupcake, you're also Mexican Cupcake? Or is that somebody else?
No, I'm Mexican. That's one of my soccer accounts.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to out you, dude. I wanted to follow you on Twitter.
It's not like everybody didn't already know, but yeah, that's me. So yeah, go ahead, follow me. I just do it for, you know, having fun and trolling people, really.
Lo hablo español. I need to practice more.
Claro que sí hablo español con un nombre como Mexicano Cupcake.
Yep. Sí,
no bueno.
Yeah, no, I speak, read, and write, and I'm fluent. My dad's Hispanic, so I've been speaking Spanish my whole life.
I'm on the west side of Cleveland, and so there's a lot. It's international village, but it's a very heavily Latino area. Norwegian cupcake, yay!
Oh, right on, okay.
More cupcakes from around the world. And I should have brushed up on my Spanish while in Los Angeles, because I had the chance to. The best my Spanish ever was when I worked with two Honduran guys in a kitchen, and I was able to pick it up very well with them, and then didn't practice it, so I lost it.
Mexicano, that's when I was working at the bakery, I had plenty of practice. They love, you know, to make fun of me.
And actually, I have a fun little politically correct joke clip while we just after we just did those two.
I'm sorry.
When Jay was a trucker, he is delivering politically correct textbooks.
The politically correct book truck's not here yet, but the driver's on the way.
When is he going to get here?
He or she, son. He or she. All is lost.
Fucking liberals, man.
Bro, dude. Bro, like, that is such a predictor of the future. Oh, my God.
I think they make the joke of kids will still believe Christopher Columbus discovered America and Paul Revere was sober.
Yeah, that's in there somewhere as well.
Yeah.
The all is lost. He or she, all is lost. Had me dying laughing so much.
Dude, this was another one of those prophetical moments, but really, wow. I think this is how long the culture war kind of has been going on, so to speak.
I want that quote one more time.
This for sure.
He or she, son. He or she. All is lost.
Sorry to cut you off of that clip. I fucking love how down he is.
Hopefully, you guys don't remember. Like, you guys, I don't know how old you were in the 90s, but I was an official teenager in the 90s. Like, it was bad. It got started, like, all this politically correct stuff. Like, you could make jokes like that.
But I was 14 in 1995, so like I was pretty aware of what was going on.
Okay.
For the most part.
I was 20 in 95.
Okay, so you're a couple years older than me. Not quite.
I was 9 in 95.
Yeah, baby face. I think we cover the whole gamut of millennial and Gen X right here between the three of us.
Yeah, right? Here we go.
The end of X, the beginning of millennial, and towards the end of millennial. Actually, no, the end of millennial. My sister is still in the 90s, isn't it?
Yeah, my sister is 30. I would say that's probably where it starts to trail off. Is early
30s. Yeah, I do feel quite X-y compared to other millennials who are on the younger side that are very much. He or she, all is lost.
Yes, I agree. That's I feel right in between Gen X and millennial a lot. Especially, I grew up with a black and white TV in my room, and my parents had the color TV, you know, like a bigger. So Mario was black and white until about 1989.
I had a black and white TV.
Change a channel with some pliers, you know, the good old days.
My family was full color, and we had HBO. My family took television. That's my grandma. Seriously.
Yeah, my grandma had cable.
My grandparents had cable as well. Yeah.
Oh, okay. And we're sidetracking again. I keep doing that. I'm a yapper. Sorry.
That's fine. We can talk about how I was able at like 3-4 years old to convince my parents to let me run into the room when the Crypt Keeper was on screen. I wasn't allowed to watch Tales from the Crypt, but I liked the puppet. So
I get
called back into the room when the puppet's doing his wrap up for Tales from the Crypt.
That's a good show. That was one I watched a lot of. Another Danny Elfman theme.
Right.
And yes, or that has been updated now. He or she or they, son. It's now, that is the update for 2024.
Oh boy. Life is too complicated.
Getting back to more simple times.
Yes, please.
We have Jay Sherman on the road when he was a trucker.
No more.
Looking very forward to being on the road.
Sitting around all day staring at a screen, I'm going to see the world.
Yep.
Fans of Desert Bus, here it is in sitcom form. Like, that's the exact clip from Desert Bus is this.
Yeah, that's the whole game, too. It's great. And it also, it's the Midwest. Yeah, and that's...
Yeah, that's what it's like.
It's hard for me to stay awake going 71 South from Cleveland to Columbus. There's just... It's that. It's rolling hills, grass, and cows. And Grandpa's Cheese Barn. That's the best thing on the way.
Why do you think I listen to all you guys' podcasts all the time? That's all I do while I'm driving my truck.
Yes, that's. I agree. Somebody's at least there talking to you.
Exactly.
The trip from Vegas, not so bad. About 3.5 to 4 hours. And similar to that was what the Desert Bus was based off of, was the trip from Vegas to Los Angeles was the exact inspiration for the Penn and Teller game that never officially was.
Speaking of Vegas, no. Are you going to Hackamania?
I will not be going to Hackamania. For me, it was either Tampa for WATP or Vegas. I would like to make it out later this year when I have some paid time built up to hit both Vegas and Los Angeles. But it's been like 10 years since I've been to Ybor City, so I was excited to get there. Vegas, I absolutely love. I have a few pointers of places to go. When was the last time you guys have been to Vegas?
I've never been, and that's why I wanted to go this time. It's still kind of up in the air, but we'll see what happens in the next couple of weeks here. I'll know for sure there, next week or so.
I was last there in, I want to say January maybe, but I'll be going to Hackmania.
Oh, nice.
I got my VIP tickets. Ticket.
Oh, you get to rub Patrick's belly if you get a VIP ticket.
Yeah, he says free belly rubs. I saw that.
Yeah, it's part of the meet and greet as well in Tampa to say hello to the performers. Yeah, a lot of fun in Vegas, but yeah, for me it was a this or that, and it's been a long time since I've been to Tampa. So hopefully later this year a Vegas and Los Angeles double shot. Have you ever been to Rebar at the end of Antique Alley?
No.
So Antique Alley, the hipsters were starting to take over that area of town, and Rebar is both an antique shop and a bar. So like all the crazy shit on the walls is for sale, but that goes for everything. The stool you're sitting in, the pint glass.
Oh, wow.
Every single thing is for sale. And they had a mystery beer gimmick. I really enjoyed that, of paying like $3.50 for a can of beer in a paper can, and it was a mystery beer. So that those were two fun things. And they had a I could really go down a rabbit hole I met a girl there at Rebar, and was planning to see her the next day, and she was like really into me, and she was like, oh, I'll be here after work. Oh, if you want to come meet me, I'll meet you on my break. I'll come and meet you at this time rather instead. I'm like, wow, she's really into me. I am gonna get my dick wet tomorrow night.
Right.
This is going on. This is happening. And so then I go back, Sabrina, basic white bitch name. And I see Sabrina there and it's like, hey, how's it going? And she looks at me just kind of confused. Hello? She was blackout drunk.
Oh, wow. She 51st dated you, man. She totally didn't remember the whole next day. Oh, no.
She was completely blackout drunk. And the reason that she told me to meet her during her break is because she wanders over from the dispensary to the bar and gets two or three shots of whiskey in that time, depending on the bartender.
Oh, so she's known even between the two. Okay. That's great. That's so good.
So I was ready to with the T-ball for sex that night to knock it out of the park. And it was like, nope. Well, that's not happening. And she had a gaggle of slinging dicks around. So one of the fun things about that was that I had the exact same conversation with her the next day.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I was able to start getting the rapport back together, having the exact same conversation in which we hit it off the night before. But the gaggle of slinging dicks around her, she went to the next place. And that's the story of the first time I got a hooker.
A lady harem. That's what she had. Choose your own adventure date, too. You get better every time you play because you know what answers to say.
That's hilarious.
Choose your own adventure date. I decided not to compete with the gaggle of slinging dicks. And I was ready for something. So you, that's the right price. I'm in. And since,
you gotta do something.
Yeah. What was I gonna do? Fuck jerking off. I was ready to knock the sex tee ball off the tee, and the tee wasn't there.
I'll take a rubber pincher too. I can use that.
So after that little sidetrack, this is a show about the critic. Did not get into the ladies of the night, but he did get into some 2001 parodies.
I want it stinks. To have my teak.
It stinks.
I know it's fallen into disrepair, but you could make it grand again.
Dear Mrs. Dinwiddie, I shall treasure it forever.
Come, tea cozy. Find comfort in my bosom one last time.
It's just a ratty old tea cozy.
A big action scene of a man dying in the middle of this boring-ass tea cozy. And I was getting excited at that point of, oh, here it comes. Here comes Jay making his shitty joke, which leads to what I have on the board.
Right. Where's the joke?
Sir, we're on the air. I know we're on the air, but where's the joke?
Where's the joke?
Luigi Greenberg has never said fuck jerking off in his life, and he doesn't ever plan to say it. When you have a litter around
litter.
All over the place.
Yes. It's littered with women.
A Sean Connery joke there. We've got the aging 007 losing his toupee, losing his dentures, and the pussy galore says, not here, galore down in the sea.
Right.
Rich full body.
Blotto Brothers.
The Orson Welles parodies. I absolutely adore. Oh, Luigi Greenberg missed that it was in Vegas. Now you get why I was like, fucking forget about this.
Yeah,
you over there. And you over there. And you over there. Which one?
I'm not going to say that. That's awful. This is one of my favorite fucking gags in the history of my favorite gags.
Having the knowledge of Orson Welles, the French, where he was getting shit-faced during that wine commercial. So having a couple of these in a row with Maurice LaMarche, like in my mind, this was the brain's voice at this time. Right. I didn't have the knowledge of drunken Orson Welles, the French. I was just like, oh, hey, it's the brain's voice.
Yeah, me too. At the same time, it was still the brain.
Tell me how you can start a sentence with in and I'll go down on you.
Pinky and the Brain actually did that word for word, except for I'll make cheese for you in place of I'll go down on you. That's something.
That's right. I'll make cheese for you.
Dude, Animaniacs got away with a lot of stuff too. There's a fingerprints joke.
Yeah, the fingerprints joke.
Fingerprints?
That comes to mind too. Oh, shoot. I did not put my charger in. I will let Orson Welles take it away while I go find what I did with my charger, which is probably right over there.
Need wine sensibly priced at $1 a jug. Now, for a little magic, I will make this jug disappear.
Rosebud.
Yes, rosebud frozen.
Yes.
Full of country goodness and green penis. Wait, that's terrible. I quit. Just a handful for the road. Oh, what luck. There's a French fry stuck in my beard.
The green penis.
The green penis. Yeah. He actually did a commercial of peas. That's where the peas come from. One of those cuts where he was doing where
snow peas from somewhere, yeah. And he was having a hard time with it. He did not like the read at all.
I think that's what the commercial is from. Yeah.
That's the one where it goes in. Tell me how you can start a sentence with in and I'll go down on you. Like that's where that comes from. I think the one we were just speaking of.
Right.
It was from the pea commercial. You're absolutely right. The wine commercial and the pea commercial. Two of the classics.
The French.
I'm going to have to find that clip while we're watching another one because, oh my God, the French. Fucking great.
I'm a maniac on the floor. And I'm dancing like I've never danced before. Hello, baby. You know what this is?
Your dog tags from the Battle of the Nerds.
You're mean.
Ew. A little Saturday Night Fever, but that wasn't good. That was how it really happened. Let's get delusion.
I don't like that memory at all. But wait, let's look at it again through the magic of self-delusion. I'm a maniac on the floor, and I'm dancing like I've never danced before. Hello, baby. You know what this is?
Your Pulitzer Prize, you luscious lump of a man.
And a big old banner. I found the French. We've got a minute 20. Let's go with the 30-second version. Or no, the 30-second version looks to be the actual commercial. We want the outtakes. We want the minute 20 version.
Oh, the French.
And
turn camera. 102, take one. With overlap, action, please.
He's so shit-faced.
He doesn't even say it. He's just standing there.
He's so hammered.
He's just so lost.
You just do anything?
No, it's sorry.
Okay.
You're rolling.
He
doesn't do
it. Ah, the French champagne has always been celebrated for its excellence. There is a
celebrated for its excellence.
In that first part, he was waiting for her to do something because he said she doesn't do anything.
He was waiting for a cue from her.
Yep.
Yeah, that's exactly right. To be honest, I was waiting for the guy to pop the bottle. I thought he had the cork in.
But he gets a bit more animated in one of these Excellent is not Orson Welles' friend right now.
The California Champagne by Paul Masson, inspired by that same French excellence. It's fermented in the bottle, and like the best French champagne,
he's swaying.
It's vintage dated. So Paul Masson.
102, take three.
Action, please.
The French champagne has always been.
Does it get more animated? Is that the one we're thinking of?
For my son.
102, take three.
Action, please.
The French champagne has always been celebrated for its excellence. There is a California champagne by Paul Masson, inspired by that same French excellence. It's fermented in the bottle, and like the best French champagne, it's vintage dated. So Paul Masson,
it gets a drunk. I agree.
I'm even doing more over the top.
BF Live. I normally do.
There's our buddy BF Live.
Turn camera.
The Bobby Fran.
Yeah, I thought he got even more over the top with the French.
He probably did, just didn't get it on camera. The French.
I haven't seen that in such a long time. I just hear it because I'm listening, you know, watching something on YouTube while I'm driving, so I don't really watch. Oh my God, I forgot how funny it was to actually watch.
It was that first take.
So here I do believe we have the commercial. While we saw the outtakes, we might as well see what the end product was.
Right.
The taste of French champagne has always been celebrated for its excellence. There's a California champagne by Paul Masson.
It's all ADR,
dude. It's all ADR.
It's all ADR.
They couldn't get a fucking thing out of him on set.
That's awful.
I'm glad we saw the final product. They were not able to cobble together a damn thing.
He did that all in a voicemail a week later.
Yeah, that's right. They held up a phone to a microphone. Excellence.
Yeah, they got the best sound quality from a phone call possible.
And by that same French excellence, it's fermented in the bottle, and like the best French champagne, it's vintage dated. Paul Masson's superb taste shouldn't be too surprising. This champagne doesn't come from France, but it was created by a man who did, Paul Masson.
And that appears ADR'd as well. His words aren't exactly matching his lips.
No, and if you listen to the whole commercial, I mean, everything sounds the same. Like it was one cut. Like it was the same tape. Like, oh my God.
They had to bring
it
back, like, yeah, the next day, the next week, in the booth.
This champagne doesn't come from France, but it was
great. Oh, yeah, look at that. That does not match.
No.
Because for it to match, you would have to say that this wine comes from the French.
By a man who did, Paul Masson. Paul Masson will sell no wine for its time.
The French. Oh, I'm glad we took that little detour. It's been a while since I saw that one, and the other famous pee commercial, that one goes on for a while.
Yeah, no, he gets really ornery in that too. Okay, so that was The Shining. I don't know what this is, and I've seen this neon sign parody,
Midnight Cowboy with John Voight and Dustin Hoffman.
Yeah, I was looking for Dustin Hoffman, and I know he's in it. I couldn't remember John Voight.
I was wondering if that was where it initially came from, because this has become, actually, I think I might have saw something kind of like this in a Twilight Zone episode.
That's what I was going to say. If it wasn't
predate, this is just such a classic shot. I think it even predates Midnight Cowboy.
I was going to say, I know the Twilight Zone. I know I've seen like something very similar where like you can tell they took the overlay because it's black and white and that's how they used to do it. But did they steal it from somebody from the 40s, you know, when they were really trying out a lot of these initial camera tricks and stuff, especially Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton and all that, those guys. Yeah, a lot of perspective and stuff.
Yeah, this is just like a very classic shot. Whoever first thought of it, it's been used many times over again. And Midnight Cowboy, they did a lot of great stuff in there. But I don't think it was originally from Midnight Cowboy. I tell people my experience with Midnight Cowboy about halfway, three quarters of the way through the movie. I was like, what the hell is this about? I don't know, but I love it.
I felt that way about I can't remember now. Easy Rider, there you go. I was just kind of watching that and I had no idea what was going on throughout the movie. It was just two dudes on a bike that eventually get rednecked to death.
Discovering what it is. And the way that trailers are nowadays, where the trailers are telling you exactly what the movie is. Back in the 80s, The Thing has a great trailer where you don't know exactly what the fuck this movie is, but it gets you intrigued.
The Shape of Water. To go see the movie.
The right. Shape of Water is one. They put the most powerful line in the trailer. I would have ripped someone a new asshole if I was a producer or a director on that. And they put the most powerful line in the movie in the fucking trailer.
Yeah, I agree.
What was it? I never saw the movie. What was it?
I forget the exact line. It's a deaf woman who falls in love with this fish man. And it sounds like a comedy. To him, there's nothing wrong with her. Like, it's a quote, something along the lines of that. To everyone else, I'm disabled. Okay. To him, I'm just me. Something along those lines that's in the trailer that after I saw the movie, I'm like, you cocksucking trailer. Are you for fucking real?
That's happened a number of times. Now. Yeah, well, they do that just to get you in the seat because I'm pretty sure they know the movie's not going to make money otherwise. They got your $7.50 now. You can storm off and be angry.
One of the worst I've ever seen of that was actually from Dexter, the season with John Lithgow. They have the preview for the next week where Dexter is stalking John Lithgow under an assumed name, and the trailer for next week, John Lithgow is in the police station. Hello, Dexter Morgan, reading his name tag. Oh shit, that was the last thing in the fucking episode. Someone should be fucking fired for that one. And everyone should have been fired for the last three seasons of Dexter and Dexter New Blood.
Yeah, I stopped watching after the John Lithgow thing, the John Lithgow season. Like, it just got dumb.
It peaked there. The Barrel Girl season in number 5 isn't bad, but it's not, it's of a lower quality, and then fucking garbage after that. I think there's 3 after that that are pieces of fucking shit.
Yeah, that's what happens. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Let's keep going.
In this shot that we don't know where it originated, but been in some of our favorite movies, as Jay is walking Paul Reiser. Some bad movie signs. Paul Reiser in Seinfeld the movie. So they recast Seinfeld with Mad About You's Paul Reiser.
I could see that happening too. That would be so good. I want Paul Reiser to do a Jerry Seinfeld documentary now. Like, he's just being. Oh, what was that one with Jerry Lewis?
Nice Lady.
Yeah, he did a movie where he was a shitty actor and was really mean. I can't remember it.
There was the King of the King New of York. Comedy? Where he
That's
was
it. Yeah. King comedy. Of Comedy, where he was like being
real. Stand up. Actually, that one's one I really need to see, being in stand-up comedy and heard a bunch of drops from. That's terrific. I know all about it. And I feel like I'm betraying the stand-up industry for never actually seeing that movie.
It's another one of those pop culture lexicon. You know it, but you haven't probably watched the whole thing. Movies.
I mean, everybody who does a podcast is a little bit of Rupert Pupkin.
Right.
He did a show from his basement.
I was asked to leave and I was escorted out. Yeah, I know so much of that movie, and being such a big stand-up comedy fan and dabbling in it myself, I should see that movie. That I should go watch it after we're done here.
Yeah, honestly. I was going to say that. I got the day off. I'm going to probably get my laundry together, and then I may have to watch that.
Yeah, that's good one deal. We definitely need to see. We definitely don't need to see Paul Reiser and Seinfeld the movie.
He's such a low rent Seinfeld, though. Like that's so true. Like, he's so low. He's such a low rent Seinfeld.
So you know the surrealness. Of,
Ma, I'm doing. What's the quote? Ma, I'm doing this.
Our favorite dabbler is a living Rupert Pupkin, the Duke of the Dabbleverse.
Yeah, I agree. Yep. It's okay.
There's a couple.
Another Dennis the Menace joke
to society, kind of like Mitchell, mischievous Mitchell would be a menace to society once he grew up.
That's such a good cartoon.
That's actually a funny gag. That's a real funny gag.
And it was really fun that the lead animator of the mischievous Mitchell got in our comments for that episode of TV Funhouse to let us know that three animators quit over the content of Mischievous Mitchell on TV Funhouse.
That was a great episode, guys. I watched that. Was a fucking great episode on the TV Funhouse episode. That was fantastic, by the way.
Thanks.
I hope a lot of people could find it and watch it. It's a good show.
Yeah, that's what kicked off my idea to do this show format of successful failures. Once Tommy let me know that, yeah, there's only 8 episodes of TV Funhouse. And God, do I love that fucking show. The network did not.
No,
at all.
No, and that show was out around the same time as this. So, you know, the PC stuff was a big deal. And so they were doing all kinds of racist shit. But not really, though, because it was animals. It was puppetry. So it's not racist. It was racial or to that effect. This one real quick, though. Bob and Carol and Beavis and Butthead. It took me a second because I was thinking some of these reference jokes. Younger people might not get who Bob and Carol are. It took me a second to remember. Like, who the hell's Carol? And it's Carol Burnett and Bob Hope.
No,
Bob
that's
Hope.
Incorrect.
That's
am I wrong?
Reference.
See what I mean? Carol, like, I'm not sure.
I think it was a movie about a couple swinging, Bob and Carol and the other Alice. Two.
Bob Carol, Bob it? And Carol and Ted. I think it's Bob Carol, Ted and Alice.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was.
See,
that's where the Beavis and Butthead reference come in. So okay. Yeah, it's a 4.
See, I missed that one. That one went right over. See, I had no idea.
For sure, like,
yeah. If I don't know much about it. I think it's a movie where Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice are planning to do some swinging with each other.
Or white swapping, correctly. Something like that.
Okay. I'm more familiar with Chuck and Bob.
So Beavis and Butthead. We're actually going to do it if they got in with Bob. Actually, no. If I remember correctly, the end of the movie, they can't do it. They just break down in a giggle fest as they're about to do it. So once again, Beavis and Butthead would not get to do it. When Keanu Reeves was a butt of a joke, now such a beloved actor.
And well, no, I made a note.
What was that movie he did that was a period piece? It was right before or after Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Okay. No, because I remember the poor accent.
Dracula. I was going to say Dracula, and I'd have to ask the internet, but yeah, I vaguely remember you know that. What? I don't know it how he did.
It may be a Mandela effect. I may be thinking of this gag.
Oh, where he does another poor accent
you
from
know,
a period.
Yeah,
piece.
I may be actually thinking of this gag because it may have been Dracula.
I know it exists. Do we not bleed? I know it exists somewhere. It at least in my universe before the Mandela effect took hold, where it was like Victorian times that Keanu Reeves was in, and
yeah.
I'm going to blank as hell.
It was the Age of Innocence or like, I don't know, but maybe.
I'll check it out too. But I made a specific note that they were ripping on Keanu Reeves. Mad TV also did a bit around the same time. It was the Keanu Reeves School of Acting. And that was a good one too, because they were just oh, it's all this. It was just straight up. It was all Bill and Ted. He was about to get typecast.
As Bill and Ted. And yeah, he's now become the action movie star. And everyone, I guess The Matrix was the big turn for our buddy Keanu Reeves.
Is that it, Stallion?
Italian Stallion. He was in another Shakespeare movie with Emma Thompson. It was Shakespeare, not just a Victorian period piece, but an actual.
Well, The Merchant of Venice is Shakespeare.
Yes.
Okay. Oh.
Oh, so, the French.
Oh,
the French. Keanu.
Have you, dude, eyes? If you prick us, do we not get bummed? If we eat bad guacamole, do we not blur chunks?
Tonight, we'll be reviewing Dudley Moore in his latest film, Arthur.
It was more of a Pauly Shore.
Blowing chunks is a Pauly Shore kind of thing.
Blowing chunks, he was not doing a Ted. He was doing that was Pauly Shore.
they're more like combining them, like they were thought of in the same vein at that
point.
Keanu Reeves and Pauly Shore. So they're just putting them all together. Oh, Much Ado About Nothing. I did that. Is that the one with Sir Toby Belch? Right. I get my Shakespeare's mixed up. I was Sir Toby Belch in one of the plays. And we did it in an outside amphitheater, and it rained one of the days. I fell on my ass. And since I was a drunkard, I actually did the Dudley Moore laugh. So I get to this clip where I'm making my big entrance as a drunk. I fell on my ass. What do I do? And then on with it.
Revenge of the liver.
Arthur, I'm afraid you have acute cirrhosis.
And you have a cute little butt.
No, you don't understand. Your pancreas is swollen to the size of a basketball.
Oh, no wonder I dribble so much.
Very much in the style of Arthur. These would fit
in. This is very serious. You have less than a year to live.
Oh, don't look now, but somebody's eaten all your popsicles. Why, there's a piano. I've got a liver the size of coconuts.
Okay, see, I missed that before. They tell you, they kind of give you who Dudley Moore is.
And that's what he was known for. He was known for 10 and then being... they actually redid Arthur with Russell Brand combined Arthur and Arthur 2 on the rocks. I don't know how many people are familiar with Arthur 2, but there's one really dumb joke that for some reason has always stuck with me, where him and Liza Minnelli are looking for apartments, and this apartment has IOL. Excuse me, landlord. It says IOL. What is that? IOL. Instant on lighting.
Nice. Nice. That hilarious. You know what? That is something that's going to stick with me now, because I like that kind of joke.
He was actually in that same movie I mentioned before, that Blake Edwards movie, SOB.
Oh. See, now there's another reason to watch it. You guys are going to go watch
Julie Andrews.
He was also in the terrible movie Best Defense that was such a fucking disaster.
Eddie Murphy.
They brought Eddie Murphy in for a week, and he has got a credit I have never seen before or since. A strategic special guest, Eddie Murphy. They inserted this new Eddie Murphy character into the movie to save it from being a complete fucking disaster and having a B plot to it with this character. Strategic special guest, Eddie Murphy.
I thought he was a co-star of that movie. I've never seen it. I thought he was a co-star.
They inserted a B plot to where he basically is the co-star. And strategic special guest, Eddie Murphy. It's in the credits as you watch the movie, because they did reshoots for a week with Eddie Murphy, especially to insert this B plot so that the audiences just would give it a chance.
Leonard Maltin says 1.5 stars, 1984, 94 minutes. Unpleasant and unfunny comedy about defense industry designer who inadvertently acquires blueprint sought after by the KGB. Strategic guest star, Murphy is no help. Thank you, Leonard Maltin of the 2002.
Oh, you've got it in a physical book. You didn't even type it in. Wow. Nice.
Here's the receipt from Walden Books from however long ago we got that. Here's a nice VHS label that it was used.
Oh, we're going to have to pick out some of those for the second episode, the Fox season.
There's going to be some good movie references in there. That's the only Critic book I got. What was that? I'm sorry.
Are you reading that by candlelight? Like, who reads a book nowadays?
Oh, yeah, I know. I'm inside a tree, actually, on Endor. The Ewoks are very, very good roommates, and we kicked the fuck out of C-3PO. He's gone.
Good thing they got some lightning bugs in a jar for you, so you can have
nice.
that light whenever.
My Star Wars stuff is in the other room. I keep it close in the bedroom.
I don't think you can really make it out, but one of my 8x10s right behind us is C-3PO and R2-D2. I suppose you can't really make out exactly what those are, but they are in camera shot every episode I'm on.
Nice. We're a bunch of team R2.
Nerds.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, we are.
All right. We are getting to the 2-hour mark. And I don't want to overstay our welcome. Let's get in a few more of this parody supercut before saying goodbye. Being a Stern Show audience, this one is appropriate to get in while we're still here.
Howard Stern's End. This
cottage. I should like to live at Howard's End forever.
You mean Howard Stern's End? I just bought the deed. What do you think of that? Any of you girls want to take your tops off?
Oh, I say.
You say, but you never do. You never put out. You're like my wife.
JK, with 2 hours of new footage. Back.
And Howard Stern was a target. I remember, actually, the Futurama joke. I think they did some more Howard Stern jabs that I'm just not remembering. But the Futurama joke of Fry screaming out in old New York, Howard Stern is overrated!
Yeah.
Which is especially fun for Billy West, who was unceremoniously dismissed from the Stern Show.
Man, I think, was Billy still on the show after the co-creator from Ren and Stimpy showed up, or was that it?
It was a little bit longer. 95, I believe, was when they couldn't come to contract negotiations. But Billy West took the strategy of just not giving him anything. He was very quiet during that confrontation with Bob K. I believe it was the name of
the guy that nobody cares about now.
Mr. Kid Toucher himself. Howard Stern brought him on air to have a confrontation, and Billy was like, the best I can do is just give him nothing. And that's kind of what Artie Lang did as well during that big bro fight. At some point after the initial back and forth, he was just given nothing and then did his job with some funny quips every now and then. So both him and Billy West knew that we're not going to win this. Let's just zip it.
Right.
Yep.
And to the left.
Exciting deleted scenes back from JFK inserted back in.
Back. To the left, back, and to the left.
Back,
to the left.
That little pause is fucking perfect. I did get a few from the Hunchback of Notre Dame musical, but we're starting to run long, so I'm gonna.
Was this before the Disney movie, The Hunchback of Notre Dame?
I believe so.
Because there was a Hunchback of Notre Dame musical.
Musical? Because I remember Disney. Movie. Yeah, I remember Disney doing the movie right around this time. I think The Critic was first.
Yeah, I believe this came first. John K., not Bob K., thank you, Luigi, was the groomer and Ren and Stimpy creator. Yeah, I believe this came first, and then the musical Disney version I believe was soon after. That's what I'm putting my money on.
Yep.
Finds her voice through her slide whistle.
Rather than the pianist, the slide whistle. This is one of those gags that stuck with me. I fucking love this parody of the pianist with the slide whistle.
The time has come for us to make love. What do you think of me naked?
We'll be reviewing Tony Curtis in The Bad News Mets.
Oh, I love this gag as well. I'm not a Mets fan, but this is a just fuck you Mets gag that I really enjoy.
All right. Which one of you threw that firecracker at the little girl? You're off the team. All right, I'm making a lineup. Who's got to go to court today? You're off the team. Now, who impregnated my daughter? Oh,
Mark. Oh, shit.
Did you catch the writing credit?
Was that Apatow?
Yeah, Apatow.
Yeah.
He's also a consulting producer on this. And I think TV Funhouse as well. Or something else. No. It was the cable guy. He was
This is the second week in a row for both Charles Napier and Apatow that we are reviewing one of their things that we love, but not a wider audience loves. Well, as I mentioned in the Cable Guy episode, I think I would have absolutely loved the original darker version of the Cable Guy.
The one that we have
now, it is lacking to me. And I really wish that we could get a version of that darker one. And Luigi, with another note of the John K. Billy West fight, it was supposed to be an ambush, but Billy got a heads up by running into him in the bathroom. So. Yep. He wasn't fully ambushed on air with this feud that he had with his former boss.
I remember Baba Booey specifically saying that, bringing that up.
Right.
Hold the mustard gas. Oh, geez.
A little silent film parody as well. My kidney.
Silas began his career at age 3 when he starred with his family in the vaudeville production Life at Our House.
We beat the shit out of each other.
There you go. And
as a young man, Silas made the transition to film this classic character, the dirty immigrant.
Which is
a version
of the tramp. But just right on the nose
of what it's supposed to. Yeah,
you guys hate these dirty immigrants. He is a dirty immigrant.
That's the. I know this scene. Yeah.
I get the two other silent clowns confused: Harold Lloyd and I can't remember his name. I forget which of the other two. What's that?
Buster Keaton.
Yes, Buster Keaton or Harold Lloyd. They legit did this gag where the front of the house fell on him. Legitimately, he had a square foot to not be squashed, and he landed.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Like, they just did dangerous stuff back then. They were trying everything out because they could film it. And that's one of the first notes I made, is that this show is very on the nose with some of their gags.
Yeah.
And as we see, Ouch My Liver was a running gag for him.
Stars of the silent screen, Silas could not make the transition to color.
Charlie Chaplin very famously made it over to, he had some great monologues. Seeing someone who's heard the Great Dictator monologue for the very first time, and they're like, whoa! Yeah. I heard that. And actually, before Film 101, I caught it on Turner Classic Movies, even before I hit Film 101. And this actually brings back some more fun Vegas memories for me. When I was working at convention, a marijuana convention in Vegas, and I had these two props that I started doing the Charlie Chaplin potato dance with, and the lady next to me actually corrected me and told me actually it's supposed to be like this, and I really regret not pursuing her more. A fit redhead who, when I was doing the Charlie Chaplin potato dance, she was like, actually it goes like this. I should have. That's one of my big regrets of not going after the lady that was like, actually the Charlie Chaplin joke goes like this. Because hearts in the eyes already with a fit redhead, and she's correcting my intense obscure reference. Oh, here we get into the
deeper
Pensacola.
Yeah, I guess it's because I lived in Los Angeles and she lived in Vegas. But 3.5 hour drive away. I should have tried to make that work with a fit redhead who's correcting my silent film.
Yeah, man. References. I think you struck out on you. Yeah, you missed out on that one, dude. If she's correcting you and how the little movements went with the, you know, dude, that's a keeper, man. Come on.
Yeah, that's one that I should have definitely pursued more. Unlike Sabrina, who I was right to just throw in the towel and pay $200 to get the rocks off with you.
$200, dude. Oh, my God.
Yeah, but they make it worth it. You got a whole hour.
And rates have gone up. $200 for an hour is now in 2024. Is now on the cheaper side. You probably want the $250, $300 an hour. The $200 ones.
See, I'd rather jerk off.
Then call Mama Backpage. She'll do it. You can pretend to be Joey C. She'll phone sex you all day.
And here we have the Phillips vision, where Duke Phillips was correcting movies that directors fucked up by not giving them a super happy ending.
Oh. There she goes, Rick. The love of your life. Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
Rick, I changed my mind. I'm coming back to you.
And I'm here too.
Rick has got his gal, and Louis is his pal. They execute the spy.
And I'm here too.
Stay tuned for all the local news. And Magnum P.I.
Duke Phillips bought repeats of Magnum P.I. that he's got to get in as well. And a little Spartacus meets Smokey and the Bandit to improve that movie with Phillips' vision.
110 minutes of Stanley Kubrick Deadwood.
Spartacus, we rigged the chariot of the Centurion.
And let's rock and roll!
Just in time for Easter.
Nobody gets away from Centurion Buford C. Augustus.
I love you, Spartacus.
And there's Jay Sherman looking just like Mars's teacher, who absolutely hated that he had that reference. Looked like John Lovitz. Oh, that's better than looking like Jay Sherman, slightly. Just slightly better to look like, because Jay Sherman,
the critic,
Jay Sherman is an uglier version of John Lovitz, who's already not a good looking guy.
As an evidence by high school high.
Hilarious though. Hilarious.
Yes.
Though.
Yeah. He is one of the, dude, he wrote a lot of good stuff for Saturday Night Live too.
Luigi Greenberg. Not going for the hour. Yes, there are also 30-minute and quick visit rates that they supply as well. You can ask Mrs. C what's going on with the current prices.
The percentage plan.
And just a few more. I believe Cuckoo's this is net. Another Phillips vision. The one flew over the cuckoo's nest. I fucking love that movie.
How'd you get this pillowcase so freaking white?
I use Phillips brand detergent. You'd have to be cuckoo not to use it.
I use it on my whites and my colors.
Nurse Ratchet?
Call me Brandy.
Chief, get down with nurse. Make 'em bacon. Mmm.
Such a powerful ending to the One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, which Duke decided, I'm going to turn it into a commercial. That's how we're going to improve on this powerful ending about a movie about, what's the fucking word I'm looking for? The ice pick in the brain. Lobotomies.
Lobotomy, yeah. It took me a second too.
And I was about to call it a day on these, but I fucking love this Jurassic Park parody as well.
You can't hold a raptor in a closet. They're too smart.
Clever girl.
You may have us, but you'll never get off the island.
I beg to differ, for you see, the other raptors and I have constructed a crude suspension bridge to Venezuela. Once there, I shall lie low and assume odd jobs under the name Mr. Pilkington. But perhaps I've said too much.
Taking the clever girl to a silly level and then an absolute just complete parody level of being able to talk. And, oh, another Honey, I Shrunk the Kids parody we have here.
Sweetheart, have you seen Timmy, Becky, and Alex?
I haven't seen them since lunch. We had fava beans and a nice Chianti.
Did you eat the kids again?
Clarice, you don't look so well. Let me again. Take your temperature.
That's a meat thermometer?
So it is, Clarice.
The not-so-thrilling tale of transformation, chicken.
I'm warning you. A full moon does strange things to me.
I've never seen this Nicholson movie. The wolf.
All right.
Cock-a-doodle-doo, baby. Don't be scared.
Scared of what? You're a big chicken.
Just for that, I'm gonna peck up your wall. Cluck, cluck.
We'll also be looking...
The scariest thing he can come up with is to peck her wall out. Rocky 5, Texas... Rocky 6, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 4. It doesn't seem like a fair fight.
No.
Marlon Brando not giving a shit.
The seal of approval.
Yes, that was Jay's replacement. He did enjoy Marlon Brando's not giving a shit.
We call him our seal of approval.
Jerry Lewis.
So this was absolutely the strongest part of The Critic were these parodies.
Yeah,
the story does lack. I wish we would have got more of Jay and his sister. There they drove off the side of the cliff because they were going to flirt with Jay, but nope, they are absolutely disgusted by him. And Marlon Brando not giving a shit again as Barney the Dinosaur.
That's right.
You don't have to lose 100 pounds to play a dinosaur. Can't even see through the eye holes on this thing. Oh,
hey, Barney's being funny.
No, I'm not. I don't do comedy. Not since The Freshman, that piece of crap. I don't know what I was thinking making that picture, let me tell you.
Freshman's a great movie. But first, if
you... Marlon Brando didn't think so, nor did the... They do shit on some of the things that we enjoy during this. Because Jay just thinks everything stinks. And Luigi Greenberg giving a thumbs up to Wolf as well. I missed that one. Looks like we've got one more movie parody, and then we'll go ahead and wrap up.
Futuristic action thriller, Robo Clapper.
Freeze, dirtbag. You're under a... rest.
Please don't do that.
That's smart. Was the... supercut that I had of the movie parodies, and I loved it at the time. Coming back at it now, I like the show. The narrative is weak. The son, he just pops in and out. It's almost like Q-Bert from Futurama, where it was a studio mandate. the fact that he just pops in and out every so often. They do have fun with the school that he goes to with all the international kids. You have a clip here of the kid from the Easter Islands.
This joke made me laugh.
The Easter Island kid made me laugh every time too.
There was an international food fight.
The French gave up immediately. We surrender. Right.
And it was the Palestinians and the Israelis that start the food fight, and then just everybody else starts joining in. I thought that was a pretty good joke.
Marty on his first date with Castro's granddaughter. As right. long as they make it to the Swedish table, they're going to be okay.
Right. You're so brave.
So there was some fun stuff there with Marty, but yeah, the dynamic with dad and son just seemed very tacked on, and I thought they could have expanded the brother sister relationship. That's, as I said, the debutante ball was top of my list for episodes in here with and
the... He's got blue blood.
Yeah,
he's got actual blue blood.
the inbreeding made him really dumb, though. He was very stupid.
Trying to count on his fingers, the math problem that she gave him. I wanted more of Margot. I thought that that wasn't explored enough, and Fox thought there wasn't enough of an emotional arc either, and they introduced two new characters, as we will talk about next time on Successful Failures. Any final thoughts? I gave my final thoughts that at the time I loved this, now I like it. They did clever things with their parodies, but the narrative, it's just kind of there. What do you guys think of it at the time and currently? Any changed opinions?
Mr. Cupcake, you first. That's the guest.
Thank you. At the time, I really dug it. Going into it again, it seems like it was just let's make a cartoon. That's
a machine for their jokes.
Yeah, exactly. The parodies were the funniest part. I'm going through the supercut. I'm like, I remember. You're talking about the episodes. I really couldn't remember specific episodes. I remembered every single one of those parodies you showed. So like that just shows the parodies over the show itself.
Yeah.
The parodies were absolutely the strong point. And the debutante ball and the finale of the dog and the fat little pig are at the top of my list for narrative, even though they're not strong narratives. There's something there in those two.
There was
the one episode with his son that I enjoyed, where he like takes him to get a guitar and tries to help his kid figure out his own talent.
Right.
Again, that is a ham-fisted episode. But I did like the stomach rolling. I knew a kid who could do that. He would roll his stomach in a weird way. So I thought that was
good. Yeah, so I thought that was hilarious. That now that my stomach is a little fat.
I agree.
I was never able to do that.
I agree with AC a bit. Some of the things feel forced. Like it was a cartoon. We're doing this to make that Simpsons money. And you see like, in the pilot episode, it was extremely ham-fisted. He's, with the rating system and stuff like that. And it's right. going to rip into critics and the people meddling with our classic films, which is, to this day, still a problem. There were some good gags in there. A shoe and a dryer was beating the critic.
Yes. The competition of the Barney the dinosaur hippo was beating them, and they did get hypnotized. That was a fun
they were watching it.
Gag.
People pay for
them
this.
Watching it and their eyeballs.
So that was like a thing that was also somewhat predictive, because we all do that now. We basically, anybody watching this is watching a shoe in a dryer, and some right. point they're gonna pay us. there was two Chevy Chase jokes that I know are specific from John Lovitz, because he hates Chevy Chase. I'm pretty
the best of coming up at 11, the best of Chevy Chase, then at 11:05.
Yeah,
the news. I forget the other one, but there was another shot at Chevy Chase, and the voice acting's good. The movie parodies are great. And like you said, there's probably things that I don't know in the background, like having to have a child in or having to hit, like with the G.I. Joe, right at the end of the thing, they give you that. The more you know, there's like that's kind of hidden in some of these episodes because I think they have to.
With strong side characters like Duke Phillips and Franklin, they helped carry this to be the silliness they wanted it to be. Narrative, yeah. Be damned. You're going to get shoehorned in there. But silliness abound. Great parodies. I love Duke. I love Franklin. And the emotional angle with Jay and his son or Jay and his sister, very underdeveloped. And I don't think they needed the son. I think they could have focused on Jay and his sister.
That could have that could have worked in place of having to add that character.
She could have been younger, and she could have been the student at there could have been a college at the, you know, the United Nations.
Yeah, there's a lot of fun United Nations jokes. Kind of my favorite part of Marty was the when we get to see him in the United Nations. And yeah, a lot of what we got with Marty could have been pushed over to Margot. And yeah, both underdeveloped relationships could have been developed if it was just one character rather than two younger characters of a sister and a child.
And real quick, two more jokes that stood out. There was the horse's ass trophy that Jay got, I believe.
It was the horse's ass that Jay's son got.
That's right.
The field day, they gave Marty Sherman a horse's ass trophy for being the worst.
He jumped backwards.
In the long jump. Yeah, yes. You would have actually done better if you would have stood in place.
That guy was laughing and everybody was good. And your American capitalist ways. Like he was like really ripping on America. And when Jay was tied up to the bed, there was an old lady upstairs that he was talking to. And the old lady thought she was talking to the cat. Like the cat had started to speak. And at some point, the old lady who was like isolated and alone got sick of Jay talking. And threw the cat out of the window because she didn't even want to talk to him anymore.
Talking cat.
Yeah.
And then the visual gag. There it goes out the window.
There's some really good. That was what I was trying to get at. There was some really good visual gags that just kind of real quick. If you're not watching, you don't see it. And one of them was they had the Jay Sherman half poster and he was half bikini baby. Like it was that.
Yeah, they were replacing the billboard. He's got his buns out.
Yeah, that you know, so little things like that. That made me really come back and like it. Because at the time, as a kid, I don't think I really cared so much. Because I hadn't seen half of the movies they were referencing. But you know, now as an adult,
half of them, as we went through all the stuff that they were referencing, got to put those on our list. A movie about swingers. What the hell am I doing not watching that?
Right.
Well, thanks for joining me today, guys. And looks like we have the same
thanks for having me.
That we're not as big of fans on this second watch through in modern day, but there is a lot of good stuff, even though it's not scoring as highly as it did with us when we were younger.
Oh, yeah. Like I said, there was also juvenile jokes that stuck out, like the hot tub not being plugged in, and Jay Sherman was making his own bubbles. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, you know, those things.
If anyone would like to join us for a post-show chat, hop on into the Dylan from Somewhere Discord. Usually me and Secret Snake spend another show length just bullshitting, trying to get that Discord going. So we'll take our post-show comments over to the Discord voice chat. Feel free to join us over there. And a shill segment. Like, subscribe, hit that notification bell to know when we are going live. This is Dylan from Somewhere over on YouTube, Twitch, and now streaming live on X as well. There is my email, dylanfromsomewhere@gmail.com, for your random creative needs. If you would like to create a parody, that's That's fun, silly stuff. I will help you with your parody. Otherwise, just watch Jay Sherman. That is the strongest part of this. So once again, I thank Secret Snake Tommy and American Cupcake for joining me here today. I thank all the beloved chatters.
Yes, those are the guys.
Yes, that helps the algorithm. Commenting after this is over helps the algorithm. So yeah, thank you so much for tuning in. Now feel free to go away.
Good night, Critic fans, and a special good night to those of you just tuning in for Home Improvement.
Bye for now.
Toodaloo. Au revoir. Auf Wiedersehen. Ciao. Ding dong day.
Places all. All join hands, circle left. Now circle right and listen to me. LS, LS, MFT. Elementary corners like swinging on a gate. To right to you, honey, with a right to left eight. Grand right and left around you go. Lucky strike means fine tobacco. Meet your honey and give her a whirl. All swing around with the little girls. Smoke them, smoke them, then you'll see. LS, LS, MFT. Promenade and don't you fall. Promenade around the hall. Lucky strike is first again. First again with tobacco men. Promenade straight down the pike. It's time right now for a lucky strike. Yes, for smoking that you're bound to like. You just can't beat a lucky strike.